the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the of his calling and what is the riches of the glory of the inheritance of the saints. This inheritance has been made available for us through God's love. We know that when Adam and Eve sinned, when they disobeyed God, and for those of us that are new, you just got saved and you don't know too much about the Bible, everybody, I don't care if you saved or not, in Sunday school, somebody then told you about Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And God told Adam, he said, "You shall not partake of this tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For in the day that you will partake of it, you shall surely die." Now, it said he told it to Adam, and I'm not quite sure, but I believe Adam had to tell Eve. Or maybe God told Adam and Eve. We're not going to add nothing to the scriptures. But they both knew that the day that they partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that they would surely die. Now, when we read that, and when I read it, even as a child, I knew that Adam and Eve didn't die. I'm thinking of it physically. They didn't die because I know they had Cain and Abel, and he had some other kids, and they was over there in the other part of the garden. When he kicked them out of that part, put them over in another part. I knew all that, even as a child. And so when you think about what God had done and what had happened, sometimes we just think, oh, he put them out, no, and they didn't really die. It's just like we know that Romans chapter 6 and verse 23 says that the wages of sin is death. See, that was the penalty that God declared from the beginning of mankind, that if man would disobey, if man would sin against God, then he would surely die. The wages of sin is death. What a sad connotation. So when we sin and when we do things we're not supposed to do, and we know that the Bible says there in Romans that the wages of sin of death, and nothing happens, we think it's a figment of our imagination. We think God is Santa Claus. We think it won't happen. But even though it did not happen physically, just like when the fig tree did not die, when Jesus walked past the fig tree, he said, I curse you at its roots. And he walked away. When they came back the next day, the disciples said, "Master, the tree that you cursed has died." When God, because this word is the word of God, and we have to believe this word to be the word of God. Now, when Adam and Eve sinned, they began to die physically, but most and foremost, they died spiritually. They were separated from God. They saw God, God saw, but in their spiritually, they were cut off. It's just like a person that's colorblind. They can see color, but they can't see blue. They can't see certain colors. It will not register on their optic nerve. That's the reason why before we get saved, we don't know why people come to church. We don't know why people give 10 cents out their money. Most of us been raised that the preacher get the money. The preacher take all y'all money and take it home. The devil is a liar. That's not true. You sitting on your money. You feeling your money. You walking on your money. You got your money in your hand. I'm not trying to go too deep, because you know, it ain't about deep. It's about us getting it. It's about us getting it. Adam and Eve, you and I, we're finite. Finite. Finite is having boundaries, limitations, circumstances. You can't help it. Circumstances happen. You have limitations on the laws of nature. You can't make the sun to shine. The sun, they tell us the sun gonna shine, sometime it's raining. We finite. We have some power, but we don't have limitless power. We don't have unlimited knowledge. We don't know everything. We can't be everything. We're finite. But God is infinite. Now, God is unlimited. He's boundless. He's limitless. He's endless. He's immeasurable. And he is the creator of everything. So when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, finite sinned against infinity or infinite. Finite man sinned against an infinite God. Limitless, the one he created, the one he breathed the breath of life in, finite, the limitless. Not omniscient, not omnipotent, not omnipresent. We're not everywhere. We can't do everything. We can only be at one place at one time. Finite sinned against infinite. So finite could not pay the penalty for its sin. So God had to take infinite, which is boundless, limitless, immeasurable creator, had to come and die or do something to satisfy divine justice. Because divine justice was, if you sin, the wages of sin is death. So infinite, because God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, they all are God. Now, sometimes we get confused about, we say, well, the Trinity, the word Trinity is not even in the Bible. But the word triune is. And we see all through the New Testament, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You see him in all, even the Old Testament, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. So the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, they all had different functions. It's just like, you a man, you a man, and you a man. You a woman, and you a woman. The woman and a woman can't have a baby. And the man can't. You got to have the opposite. And so if God is infinite, then that means that there's nothing above him. There's nothing above him. If you go to heaven, he's there. If you go to hell, he's there too. He's created it. He has authority down there. He has all authority. God created Adam. God created the devil. But Satan was not meant to be the devil. He was supposed to serve God. He was called the archangel. He was the one that sang. He was the one that was over the praise and the worship. He was the one that would have directed the choir. The Bible said he was made with pipes in him. So when he spoke, he just went, oh, hallelujah. And he even was beautiful, the Bible says. But see, beauty and talents and gifts sometimes take us way beyond the limitations and the boundaries, and because we're finite. And so Jesus God infinite, ex Father infinite, I'll go. Prepare me a body, and I will go. So infinite had to take care of the debt that we owed to God for disobedience. I'm going to give you another word. It's called vicarious or substitutionary atonement. Vicarious or substitutionary, it means to take the place of another instead of that person. Now, you know what substitute means. When you're in school, you get a substitute teacher. If the teacher's sick or the teacher's out anything. I mean, if I'm not feeling good, or if I'm, you know, I'm ready to take my sealer, we get a substitute. But the substitute for the main person that's in there. So if it's a teacher, you have the main teacher. The substitute is not the main teacher. The substitute is the substitute. And so when Jesus substituted, he sinned. He was out. He was without sin. He couldn't sin because he's infinite. He cannot sin. He cannot lie. He cannot die. But yet, because he's infinite, he could do what he want to do. Because he's all powerful. He's all knowing. He can be anywhere at any time. So he had to take God. Jesus as God had to come to take our place, a substitute, vicarious atonement, a substitutionary atonement.